pertinence was delivered by none other than the mechanical engineering professor, Professor Festus Oyewale. And we had the last one most recently by our erudite professor, Professor Taiwo Olubumi Abioye. The topic of our lecture was, by words they were created, a synergy between language, discourse, and the media in the construction of realities. It is our expectation that this lecture, just like all the others have always been, we steer public discourse about child and adolescent abuse and reinforce efforts directed at reducing the scourge. We hope that members of the public will find space to further this conversation and put it in the right perspective in the public agenda. It is on this note, I bid you welcome. You are most welcome.
Shall we once again put our hands together for the Chancellor, Vice Chancellor of Covenant University? Thank you. It's time to unveil the inaugural lecturer. And to do justice to this, I want to invite Dr. Susan Dewusi. Shall we put our hands together for her? Thank you.
The Chancellor, ably represented by the Education Secretary, the Vice Chancellor, sir, permit me to stand on the already established protocol. I humbly request that the 13th inaugural lecturer of Covenant University, Professor Abiodun Matthew Gesinde, rise as I read his citation. Professor Abiodun Matthew Gesinde was born on the 28th of December, 1968 in Shaki to the family of Mr. and Mrs. George Gesinde, but he is a native of Oyo Town in Oyo State. Professor Gesinde's academic race started when he finished his O-level in 1986 from Ojogbodu Grammar School, Oyo. He had Bachelor's of Education in Guidance and Counselling in 1992, Master's in Guidance and Counselling in 1995, Management Information System in 1998 from Federal College of Education Special, Oyo State, and his PhD in Counseling Psychology in 2004. His first, second, and third degrees were from Premier University, University of Ibadan, Oyo State. Professor Abiodun Gesinde started his academic career in February 1996 with the Federal College of Education Special, Oyo State, as an assistant lecturer and rose to the position of principal lecturer in 2008. He worked as adjunct lecturer for the University of Adoekiti, 1997 to 2008, University of Ilorin, 1999 to 2001, and Adair Landmark University, 2011. He joined Covenant University as a senior lecturer in the year 2010 and served as the head of department in psychology from 2010 to 2012. Professor Gesinde had served and still serving as a member and head of different committees in the university. He was the sub-dean of College of Leadership Development Studies 2015-2016 session. Research interest. He has written extensively in counseling people with special need, psychological abuse, career counseling, and behavioral disorder. To the glory of God, Professor Abiodun Matthew Gesinde has several awards and supervised a number of PhD theses. He has, to his credit, over 62 articles in reputable journals and authored 3 books, 17 chapter contribution in books, 9 edited and published conference proceedings, and one magazine publication. Thank you. He is a member of editorial board and reviewer of local and international journal, including our prestigious Covenant International Journal of Psychology. He is a member of American Psychological Association, International Society for Prevention of Child Abuse and Neglect, Association of Professional Counselors in Nigeria, Counseling Association of Nigeria, and American Counseling Association. So far, Professor Abiodun Gesinde has attended over 11 workshops, 49 conferences within and outside the shores of Nigeria. Professor Abiodun Gesinde is married and blessed with 3 boys. Join me welcome our 13th inaugural lecturer of Covenant University, Professor Abiodun Gesinde.
Counselor, and other eminent professors we have here. Sir, I will make a request, sir. When I look at the list of protocol, if I should read everything, that's another electoral lecture. So please, just permit me to stand on the existing protocol, please, sir. I have just 45 minutes, and I just want to maintain that period. First of all, I want to thank God for this wonderful opportunity to be alive. I also want to appreciate the Chancellor of this university for the approval given to my nomination by the VC. I thank God for that. And I'm so happy today because if you look at the table here, I have 2 of my teachers here, those who taught me in the university. And that's wonderful, that's awesome. I have Professor Alawo, and I was pronounced a professor in October 22, 2013 by Professor C.K. Ayo. I don't know whether he's around. I appreciate that. And it was because I have been pronounced a professor, that's why I'm here to provide, how to produce, make this inaugural lecture. Now, I want to stick to that 45 minutes. And I want us to look at this. Are you there, studio? Can we just start, please? Next slide. Now, I want us to look at this. Nigeria is a developing country. And I'm asking a question here now. If a country is developing and virus is troubling the adolescents and children, what do you think would be the future of the country? And this is really what we are going to talk about here. And of course, if you ask for my own response, talk of bleak future. I said we want to apply faith. And not only that, if the future is bleak, okay. Now, if the future is bleak, well, I also want you to predict the fate of the children. And this is exactly what we want to talk about now. If you talk of virus attacking children and adolescents, then you know that there's a problem with the nation, and there's a problem even with the children and adolescents. We are here because of human abuse, and I want to talk about this. This will explain what we are talking about. Next slide, studio. Now, when you talk of human abuse, you divide it into 4. We have the child abuse, we have the adolescent, we have the adult, and the aged. Under this, we have different forms. For the child, we have the physical, we have the emotional, we have the sexual, and we have the neglect. For all. If you look at it, by the right-hand side of the diagram, we have 3 of them as being active, while the last one, neglect, is passive. Now we have the child abuse, and we have the adult abuse. In other words, it is when you combine the children and adolescents together that you have what we call child abuse. So let me just explain this. So when we talk of child abuse, we are not talking of somebody that is just 10 years old, something that somebody that is just 18 years old. We are talking of somebody that is up to 21. Because if we are to combine childhood period and adolescent together, it will be more than 18. Because psychology will tell you that, well, at least for somebody to be an adolescent, you must have reached the age of 21. So this is exactly what we are talking about. So when I make reference to child abuse here, please don't think that we are talking of somebody that is just as young as 4 years, 3 years, or 2 years. So now, from what we have here, you discover that we talk of four areas. We talk of physical, we talk of emotional, we talk of sexual, and we talk of neglect. Now, out of this, I just pick one as my area of interest, which is emotional. And of course, when we move on, you will realize that emotional abuse is the same thing as psychological abuse. And again, I want to say this. In the process of working on emotional abuse, I have publications on physical abuse, I have on neglect, I have on sexual abuse. But at times I talk about all together. For instance, now when you talk of etiology of child abuse, you have to combine all together. When you talk of prevalence of child abuse, you can talk about all. So, but because the focus of this lecture is on psychological abuse, I want to move straight to psychological abuse, despite the fact that I have some findings on sexual abuse, on physical abuse, emotional abuse, and the likes. But I want to summarize physical abuse and neglect this way. Studio, the first video clip, please. So that when we are talking of an adolescent. Now, I said we have four forms: physical, sexual, neglect, and emotional. And I pick emotional, which is also psychological. Somebody will now want to know why. Why psychological abuse and not other areas of child abuse? Now, the first thing I discovered is that all human beings are directly or indirectly involved in psychological abuse, either as perpetrator or victim, whether you like it or not. Then number two, I also discovered that it's the most common abuse in homes, schools, workplace, and even religious centers. And of course, its presence is detectable in physical and sexual abuses as well as child neglect. Now, let me explain this a bit. You have watched video clips on physical abuse and neglect. In these two cases, there is element of psychological abuse. So in other words, if you are abused physically, you also suffer psychological abuse. If you are abused sexually, you also suffer psychological abuse. So it's one of the reasons why I say, okay, this one must be very, very important. And of course, it's hidden nature. When you are psychologically abused, there will be no scar. It will appear as if nothing has happened. But in the real sense of it, in fact, I call it apanimayo than Yoruba. That's a killer without sword. Then, of course, you talk of the pains. When you talk of the pains from consistent psychological abuse from others, then you might not be able to quantify it, except you pass through it. And then, of course, I also discovered that people underrate it to be something small. Maybe he just abused you. What is the big deal in that? And of course, to the best of my knowledge, at least in this part of this world, it is not a law-breaking offense. And I also discovered, of course, I've went to so many churches. I've never seen a place whereby they will say, okay, let's pray that we not suffer from psychological abuse. Probably maybe after this lecture, they begin to pray directly about it. I don't know. And of course, the last point which I discovered has to do with family. Of course, they used to talk of women being what? That they are not strong, they are weak and all that. In other words, they might find it very difficult to abuse physically, but they use this to deal with their husband. They use psychological abuse to deal with their husband. So these are some of the reasons why I have interest in this. Then again, I talk of psychological virus instead of psychological abuse. I think this is the area where some people will have problem with my work. That what is psychological abuse? More so when you Google it, you are not likely to get anything reasonable. But I want to justify the use of psychological virus. And I want to look at it from the point of psychology itself, then we pin it down to the virus that we are talking about. When you talk of psychology, you talk of a word that has its origin from two Greek words, psyche and logos. And when you translate that, what you are going to get is mind and study. So in other words, when you talk of psychology, psychology is just about the study of mind. You talk of human mind. And of course, when you talk of human mind, there is opportunity to present stimulus to the mind. And of course, get a response from the stimulus that will now affect the mind. So I now talk of something like the stimuli could make or mar the soul of an individual depending on what they carry. So when you present a stimulus, there's two probability now. It's either such you make such an individual or destroy the life of an individual. So in my view, any stimulus that is introduced into the human mind and is capable of mutilating the soul is virus. When you present anything and it such thing will now destroy the life of an individual, I see it as a virus. So in this lecture, it is my submission that there is a stimulus which, when presented, has virus-like nature in the field of psychology. When you present, they have this virus-like nature. And of course, when you talk of the word itself, virus, it's even interesting that the man that even discovered it was not even a computer scientist. From what I have here, it's likely to be a biologist or something like that. I'm not sure. But when you talk of virus itself, I realize that virus, when you look at attributes of virus, what we have in virus, we also have in psychological abuse. What you have in virus, you also have in psychological abuse. So attributes of virus is very, very, attributes of virus are very, very dangerous whenever it's found. Attributes of virus are very, very dangerous whenever it's found. And then virus as a term is mostly used in the field of medicine and computer science. Now, these are my reasons why I have to call it psychological virus. Number one, when I look at the account of the origin and historical development of the world itself, I have not found a place whereby they put it there that it is only in computer science and medicine that you can use virus. Of course, let me say this, virus is interpreted to mean poison. Virus is interpreted to mean poison. So when I look at the historical development or the historical account of the world itself, there was nowhere I read that, okay, it is only in computer science or in medicine that you can use virus. Then again, in psychology itself, we have a field of psychology that we call medical psychology. And of course, when you talk of medical psychology has something to do with medicine. So my question now is, if they are using virus in medicine, and we have an applied field of psychology, which is medical psychology, then what stops us from using the word virus? And then to the best of my knowledge too, the virus in computer is not the same virus in the field of medicine. I don't know. Professor CK is not here. Probably you might need to confirm that. Or is it possible for a virus in a computer to just jump into a human being? I'm not sure that is possible. So I think the time virus is adopted in both fields because of its destructive potentials. Then some dictionaries describe virus as anything that corrupts or poisons the mind or character. That's one other thing I discovered. They define virus as something that poisons the mind or character. And of course, psychological virus about virus-like abuse in the human soul suffered by all categories of human beings, from significant and non-significant others. Yoruba adage, you say, omi eko, eko ni. So in other words, water in a pap is also the same thing as. Now, what are we saying? If you call something virus-like, and Yoruba people will say, omi eko, eko, then it's like we are saying the same thing. And then the word abuse itself, I'm not comfortable with it, because unlike virus, it's undermining the life-threatening or deadly nature of what psychological abuse people have to pass through. Because they call it abuse, people are just looking at it as something that is very, very simple, that you don't have to make noise about it. But when you hear virus, definitely you know that we are talking of something that is very, very serious. So just like virus in human being will make a person malfunction, or virus in a computer crashes the system, so also the psychological virus could cause psychological retardation or psychological kwashiorkor in human beings. So we are not going to joke with virus. Now, in this lecture, the word abuse is presented as a virus or poison that has capability to injure or crush the human soul. So when I talk of psychological virus in human being, which is the introduction of poison into the mind or soul, so I pick psyche, which is soul, and I change abuse to virus. So when I profess of virus-like abuse, both mind and severe, that is targeted at human being, human soul, with the sole intention of making the soul impotent, this my focus. I talk of virus-like abuse that when it is introduced or injected to the human soul, it will cause pain to the soul and weakens or paralyzes the normal activities of the soul. I talk of poison-like event or occurrence that is non-violent but has controlling power to threaten the peace of the soul. I talk of poison-like interrelationship that are detrimental to the rest of the mind. I talk of non-violent but poison-like interaction that will not allow the living soul to praise the Lord. I talk of non-violent action or inaction that is targeted at human being and will remove the merrymaking from his or her dictionary for a while or forever. I talk of non-violent event that will make one forget the past days of joy. I talk of viral abuse that is capable of generating suicidal thoughts or bring about heart attack or failure. And I talk of poison-like but non-violent abuse that will make a child to query the paternity or maternity of his parents. Now, I try to check the word soul in the Bible, and surprisingly, I got it in the second chapter of the Holy Bible. That's Genesis 2:7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living soul. Man became a living soul. Then I asked a question. What will become of a living soul when a virus is injected into it? I hope we are not going to have a dying soul at the end of the day. That's just my fear. Now, if you look at the Bible again, there are other places where the top of Bible abuse and pains that somebody might pass through because of challenges with the soul. I look at Mark 14:34. We might not be able to talk about that. I talk about Luke. I talk about Acts. There is this aspect of it that I talk about what Mary will pass through because of Christ's suffering and all that. So it's my final submission that the soul is not only precious to the creator of heaven and earth, but that the soul is life. Therefore, anything that makes the soul to experience pains, sorrow, dejection, diseases, depression, thereby making it become impotent, is virus-like. Then I talk about what is abuse. There are so many things here. When you talk of abuse, we are made to understand that you can also use the word misuse, mistreatment and misapplication and all that. And of course, when you misuse something, definitely such thing will not be able to generate what it is designed for. So when you talk of abuse again, I was made to understand from the dictionary that you can also talk about something that is injurious when you talk of abuse. And of course, when something is injurious, there are so many words that you can use. You talk of something that is heartbreaking, heart-rending. You talk of something that is terrible. You talk of something that is shocking. You talk of something that is tragic. So when we talk about psychological abuse of virus in the human soul, we make reference to something that shares similar features with these words. So what I've done is just to let you realize that when we call it abuse, it's like we are yet to get the proper meaning of what we are working with. Now, what is psychological abuse? Of course, psychological abuse is one of the forms of children and adolescent abuses, as we have said. And of course, there are other words that you can use in lieu of this psychological abuse. They are listed here: emotional abuse, psychological aggression, mental abuse, emotional neglect, psychological maltreatment, and psychological terror. Now, I call it emotional abuse. That's to tell you that it has something to do with emotion. And of course, when you talk of emotions, there are so many things that are attached to emotion. There was a time I pointed out that the emotional state of an individual determines how the individual will interact with the other members of the society, or how such an individual will perform his or her regular duties. And of course, when you talk of emotion, emotion is not limited to the adult. We also talk of emotion of children. And I want this video to confirm that. Studio number 3. I just want to use this clip to confirm the emotion of children in real life. This is not African magic. And of course, as you are watching this, you know I said we present stimulus that can affect soul, that can make or mar soul. Let's see what is going on here. Oh yeah, go on, please.
Kai, he's 4 days old now. He's getting ready to get his first bath at home. Oh, we heard mommy say that. So
it's so hard to get naked.
Next one. We talk of presentation of stimulus.
Like an angel in the morning, shooting star across the night. The most beautiful girl I've seen in all my life. Every second spent with you is like a day that starts brand new. Girl, I'm so amazed at all the things you do. Yes, I wanna build my whole world around you. So I promise you forever and for always.
Please stop it. Now, when you talk of emotion, you talk of something that will stir you up somehow. And if you compare what has happened to the children, of course, and compare it with what has happened to the adults, definitely something has been presented, and you can see the reaction of their soul. Now, if the mental state is positively stirred up, positive or pleasant feelings of joy, excitement will manifest in an individual. On the other hand, if the mental state is negatively stirred up, which is usually the case in psychological abuse, unpleasant feelings of sadness, sorrow, pains, trauma will be the experience of an individual. And this one is very, very important. So it has to do with what is presented and how your soul will react to it. Now, we talk of one of the main difficulties about emotional abuse is the definition of it. But notwithstanding, we have some definitions from international organizations and individuals. Now, we have one here from the American Professional Society on Abuse of Children, Psychological maltreatment means a repeated pattern of caregiver behavior or extreme incidents that convey to children that they are worthless, flawed, unloved, unwanted, in danger, or only of value in meeting another's need. And of course, we have another definition which talks about pattern of behavior. So I mean, we don't want to waste time on that. So when you now talk of psychological abuse from various definitions, you talk of the controlling or overpowering of someone's emotion by a perpetrator. Such an individual is having power that will control, it's like you have a remote control that will now say, oh yeah, cry, oh yeah, laugh, oh yeah, smile, oh yeah, sit down. It has to do with the control of somebody's soul. And I love Yoruba language very, very well, because I saw some words in Yoruba language that have described this the concept of psychological abuse. Like in Yoruba language, we have what they call gba. No, we have gba, which is take. But we have gba. Now, when you talk of gba, that's you eat. Okay. That means you eat somebody. Now, and when you join it with some other words, what they talk about is that they can say something like mugba leti, mugba loju, and all that. Then they can also say something like mugba loro, mufuro gba uriye. In other words, the same gba which is it, they are now using it to abuse. Mugba loro. In other words, so what I'm talking about here is that when you now use something like that, the same it for physical abuse, and you are now using the same word it for psychological abuse, in other words, you have a kind of similar intention. In other words, to cause pain in such an individual. That's how Yoruba we. And of course, one other interesting thing about it is that when you eat people with words, at times you feel satisfied that you have dealt with him or her. I don't know whether you experienced that. It's like, yeah, I caught him. So in other words, we are talking of the same pain now, physical pain and psychological pain. And incidentally, we have been told from scientific findings that the same part of brain that become active in response to painful sensory experiences also is the same that you are going to use when you have social rejection. The same part of brain will be activated, if it is social rejection or physical pain. The same part of the brain will work it out. So this is why it is very, very important. Of course, I have it in Bible too, which time will not permit me because I've been given time to... It is well. So now, let's look at this. These are samples of children being abused by adults. Then we talk of who abuses children. Of course, you are the one. You are the one. So we talk of perpetrators, we talk of parents, we talk of relatives, we talk of caregivers, and when you talk of percentage, we have 77% of perpetrators as parents, we have 11% as other relatives and the likes. Now, let's talk about tactics they use. There are two tactics, neglective and deliberate. In other words, when you talk of neglective tactics, the abuser will withhold normal human interaction. And then when you talk of deliberate, of course, definitely they do things. It's not that they are doing it, they are not aware of it. And of course, let's talk about the dimension of psychological abuse. I identify some of them: isolating, degrading, exploiting, rejecting, corrupting, terrorizing, and ignoring. Wow. Then we have different types. Emotional isolation is the first one, which is restraining or putting a limit to individual ability to socialize with others. Then we talk of degradation. This occurs when individual self-worth is reduced to nothingness. And then we talk of so many things I want to talk here at that time will not permit me to talk about. Then we talk of emotional exploitation. This involves manipulating child's activity or forcing the child to carry out certain activity that will benefit the manipulator. And then we talk of rejection. And of course, when you talk of rejection, from the dictionary point of view, it's an act of refusing to accept somebody or something. And, And corruption, this is an emotional socializing. And of course, I talk of the definition that is coming from Transparency International. Now, I want to use this illustration to explain emotional corruption. Now, I was listening to radio one day, and one woman said she parted with her friend when her mother told the two of them in Yoruba language that Kosemani ni Alenini. And when you have to interpret that, it means as a married woman, you cannot do without concubines. That's a typical case of emotional corruption. And let's look at it. I want us to read this. This is just an hypothetical case. Now, if you have been told that Kosemani ni Alenini, that is, your marriage cannot succeed without having concubines, and unfortunately for you, you marry somebody that you did not love, and in your workplace, you now find somebody that you love. So how would that affect what you have been told before? If you like, say it can never happen. Then we have emotional terrorism, which is an act of terrorism that is used. An act of terrorism is the use of extreme fear to intimidate people. Time is not my friend. Emotional ignoring. And when you talk of emotional ignoring, it's to intentionally disguise someone or something. I have some video clips here that I wanted to use to back all these dimensions up, but time is not my friend. Then measurement of psychological virus. To the glory of God, I developed one instrument that we can use to measure emotional virus. And I want to give the FC a copy of this, if I'm permitted. Sir. Thank you. Now, that scale can be used to measure psychological virus. I have to move on. Then we talk of researches conducted on psychological abuse. I identify 8 areas that I've worked on psychological abuse. And I just want to pick 2 because time will not permit me to talk about the 8. Then we talk of the frequency of occurrences of 7 dimensions of emotional abuse and their influence on gender and family. In other words, I'll try as much as possible to find out from adolescents whether they have been abused psychologically at home. And I use all the 7 dimensions. And this is what I got. Okay, this one will present it well. Look at isolating is the first experience and followed by others. Time will not permit me to talk about it. I also work on the impact of 7 dimensions of emotional maltreatment on self-concept, because it has been discovered that one of the effects of psychological abuse is low self-concept. So I work on this and I have my findings here. Time is not my friend. Now let's talk about how psychological virus will affect the children and the nation. So from what we have said so far, it will be self-deception to ensure that its influence will be positive on the children and the nation. Of course, its effect will undermine psychological, socio-cognitive development. And of course, for the development, I have to click classical examples of how psychological abuse will affect weight. There was a woman that carried out a study. She wanted to increase the weight of children. And she has 2 groups, experimental group and control group. So for the experimental group, she fed them for 6 months with good food. And then for the control group, they were just left like that, eating normal food. At the end of the 6 months, she now discovered that the experimental group gained less weight, even with the enriched food. And she was wondering, what might be the problem? If you are eating well, then that should reflect in your weight. But the case is the other way around. She now discovered that when children are eating, we have a supervisor that used to rebuke them, that used to abuse them. So as a result of that, they were just eating. The food was not having any effect on their body. So when you talk of psychological abuse, it means that the effect can be on your physical development as well as on your psychological development. It is well. Now, When you talk of developing country, as we started from, you know, there are so many features of developing country. And this will include external debt, inadequate social infrastructure, poor medical services, unstable government, maladministration, and all that. Now, I ask a question that if this is what we have in developing countries, will they have time to meet the psychological needs of all children and adolescents? Then will the children and adolescents that have been psychologically imprisoned, battered, and shattered make meaningful and adequate contribution to the national development? That will be very, very difficult. I talk of some other studies. Okay. It is well. It is well. So let's talk about treatment, which is the antiviral that we have in this whatever. So in cases of virus in the soul or mind, I strongly believe that the computer software, medical prescription of drugs will be helpless, but an applied field of psychology such as counseling psychology will do wonders to liberate the victim of the abuse. Wow. Now, when you talk of what counseling will do, I identify three areas here. You talk of therapy based on perception. You talk of therapy based on psyche, capacity to eat, and you talk of therapy that will let you acquire certain psychological skill. The first one is cognitive therapy, the second one is sound therapy, and the third one is assertiveness training. Wow, wow, wow. I may not be able to talk about all because of time. Well, by divine privilege, I've been able to supervise 4 PhD theses. And of course, I was also given this opportunity to assess some professors from other universities. So let me make my recommendations. As we have family doctors and pastors, so do I recommend that we have family counselors who will diagnose the existence of psychological virus in our families, among other professional responsibility. And also, we have been told that there is problem of psychological abuse in school. So premise of my strong belief that all human problems cannot be spiritual, I want mission schools to review the way they underutilize counseling services in their respective institution with a view to maximizing its overall benefit. Now, let's talk about what I intend to do. I want to shift away from, to a certain extent, shift away from parent-children psychological abuse. I want to move to wife-husband psychological abuse. And sincerely, I've started. There was a paper I presented in 2016. If you look at the title, I don't know whether you are able to see it very well. That will give you an idea of what I intend to do. I talk of victimization of men in spousal abuse reports, the reality and implication for domestic violence counseling. Yeah, this is October 22, 2013, when I was pronounced as a professor of counseling psychology. I want to appreciate everybody. I want to thank all those who have contributed to my life, all my teachers that are here. I remember my uncle who brought me into counseling field. I want to thank all those I've worked with in the past, especially at the Federal College of Education. They are wonderful people. I also recognize my HOD and other faculty. I mentioned your names here. I did not omit anybody. I want to thank others that have come for this purpose. To God alone be all the glory.
Shall we keep putting our hands together as we create the inaugural lecturer? Thank you. May we please be seated? You will agree with me that this lecture by our erudite professor, seasoned scholar, intellectual extraordinaire, Professor Abiodun Gesinde, has been very inspiring, stimulating, illuminating, and enlightening. Shall we once again put our hands together for him? Thank you very much, sir. At this point, I want to respectfully invite the Vice Chancellor of Covenant University for the next assignment. Thank you, sir.
if you have truly enjoyed that lecture, can we give him another round of applause, please? We're seeing something new in our series of public lectures. It's becoming more entertaining. Thank you for that disruptive approach to the delivery of the Covenant University lecture series. Ladies and gentlemen, at this point, I would like to seek your indulgence to please rise as I most very humbly invite the Chancellor of Covenant University for his remarks. Chancellor, sir.
Please take your seat. Praise the Lord. I'm here to represent the Chancellor, Dr. David Oyedepo, who would have loved to be here in person, but because of his several obligations, he's asked me to stand in for him. First, the Senate, the Vice Chancellor and Senate, the inaugural lecturer, members of the university management, staff, students. I want to say that this lecture is a true to life lecture. It's something that we have either witnessed or experienced ourselves, or we have seen children, adults, adolescents being abused. And because of the global recession, it is on the increase. The lecturer did justice by trying to define some basic concepts. Also, he happens to be one of my students, and so I'm a proud teacher today. Because of global recession, and because the world has become such a place whereby parents are so busy, they hardly have time for their children. They entrust them to people they hardly know, or even family members they think they trust. And a lot of abuses take place. Just yesterday, I think I saw, was it on social media, a stepmom that uses hot iron. She will plug the iron, and when the stepdaughter misbehaves, put hot iron on the skin of that little girl. You saw one, a little baby that was thrown to the floor as if she was a piece of used item. I think that the virus is there, and we have either seen it, witnessed it, and sensitizing us to it makes us to be alive to what we should do, either as a whistleblower or informant, should it happen around us. Also, I know that as a faith-based mission, one antivirus that is so effective today, tomorrow, and forever is the Word of God. We should teach our children from very little to believe in themselves. Let them know they are fearfully and wonderfully made. Let nobody, you know, build the confidence of your children from when they are very little. Let nobody talk them down or put them down. That is not to say that we should ask our children to confront authorities. But when you build confidence in your word from very little with the word of God, they can go anywhere, and they will stand their own. I think the lecturer was able to bring that aspect out to say that, you know, I saw analysis. Time did not allow him to go, you know, page by page, what he would have liked to say. The word of God. Now, of all these abuses, you have physical abuse. That's quite obvious to see. But emotional or psychological is covert. You don't see that. Although it exhibits through behavior. You can turn someone to a nervous wreck if that person is abused emotionally. Sometimes he doesn't even know what to do to get it right. So this time is hardly enough to do thorough justice. But I think the lecturer has done his best within the time that he had to bring us to book. I mean, to scale on this topic. So those of us who have it, we can take it back and we can look at it again. He also developed an instrument that can be used. And I want to say that for the school network, we would like to have copies of this instrument because, yes, we have guidance counseling units in the school, but this instrument will also enrich the materials that we have in the school network. So on behalf of the chancellor, I want to appreciate the inaugural lecturer and all those who have provided support to him to be able to do justice to this lecture. And I will take back a copy of the lecture today to the chancellor. And I also want to appreciate all of us who have made time out of a very busy schedule to be here to witness this inaugural lecture. And I pray that as we go back to our various assignments, that God will speedily fulfill the prophecy of the year, which is new dawn in the lives of everyone. Thank you very much.
Shall we once again put our hands together for the Chancellor of Covenant University? May we please be seated. This inaugural lecture has brought a lot of guests to Covenant University. We would like to recognize some of them at this point. We want to specially acknowledge the presence of counselors from different universities. We have some from Crawford University, Leeds City University, from Lagos State, from different organizations, including the Bells Secondary School. Please, once I call your name, just raise your right hand up just to acknowledge that you're here. We have Dr. Elebwede Bola, Director CGD. You're welcome. We also have Mr. Eruveme Emmanuel, Grain Royal, and Omofo Ogale from Grain Royal. We also have Mrs. Ogunleye Mary, Counselor from Bernadette, St. Bernadette. Are you here, ma'am? You're welcome. We also have Mrs. Adetutu Motorayo from Bells University, Counselor. You're welcome, ma'am. We also have Dickness Bodelati, Principal, Covenant University Secondary School. We also have Mrs. Shoni Barre, also a counselor from Covenant University Secondary School. We have Dr. Akoni, from all the way from Oyo State. You're welcome, sir. We also have Mrs. Olajide from Crawford University, counselor. We have Ms. Kate Amadin. We also have Professor Donald Odeleye, the counselor from Leeds City University. You're welcome, Prof. Thank you. We deeply appreciate all of us for coming here today. We appreciate you for being a part of today's event. But to formally situate this appreciation, we'd like to invite the director, Covenant University Counseling Center, Professor Olujide Adekeye, to move the vote of thanks. Thank you.
Let me start by giving all the glory to God Almighty for making today's occasion of the 13th inaugural lecture of Covenant University a resounding success. To God alone be all the glory. Amen. I want to thank the Chancellor, ably represented by the Education Secretary, Living Faith Church Worldwide, Professor Bridget Sokon. Thank you for coming. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to be in our presence. We thank you and we appreciate you. Our special appreciation goes to our Mabel Vice Chancellor, Professor A.E. Atero, a quintessential leader. I also salute the DVC, the Registrar, and all other principal officers of Covenant University. I appreciate your presence here. And to the man of the moment, our erudite 13th inaugural lecturer, Professor Abiodun, Matthew Gesinde, I say a big thank you to you, sir. You made the Department of Psychology proud. I believe we have all profited from this lecture, which was quite educative and illuminating. My thanks also go to the family of Professor Gesinde, to our invited guests, to our friends and other well-wishers. We thank you for sharing our joy. I cannot but recognize the presence of faculty, staff of Covenant University, and to the kings and queens here present, thank you for being good, thank you for being patient, and thank you for being teachable. I want to thank members of the press here present. I want to thank the CU band. I want to thank the CU ushers and other supporting units. You are well appreciated. As you go, I wish you all God's protection and journey masses to your various destinations. Thank you and remain blessed in the mighty name of Jesus.
Shall we once again put our hands together for Professor Olujide Adekeye? We have a few announcements. We would like to announce that there will be a cocktail event at the end of this program, and our invited guests, that is the visitors of the university and members of the Senate, are invited. Venue is the CLR conference room just opposite the chapel. The lecture booklet is also available at the entrance, and with the ushers, we request that you pick a copy. May I invite the chaplain of Covenant University, Pastor Promise Omidiora, for the closing prayer. Shall we arise, please?
Let us pray. Father, we want to thank you. We call upon you at the beginning and you were with us. Thank you for the strength, both inner and outer, that you gave to the lecturer of the day. Thank you, Almighty God, for what you have done in his life. And thank you what you are beginning to do even from this time forward. We return all the glory to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Almighty God, for bringing all the guests here safely. We trust you, Lord Jesus, to take each one of them back to their various destinations in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Almighty God, for the testimonies in Covenant University, even at the event of today. As we begin to move the university forward again, Lord, we return all the glory to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we give you praise for everything that has taken place here today. Blessed be thy holy name, Lord. In Jesus' great name, we have prayed. Amen.
While we are still standing, the Covenant University Band will take the Covenant University anthem, after which we'll have the academic procession in reverse order. CU Band, please.